What he was kind enough not to tell you is how much my son beat me in every game that he put on. And he's like, no, 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 this will be good for you for your talk. Let me beat you in 3D instead of just 2D. And he did. When I was invited to be a part of today's conference, we looked at a number of the things that I teach to MBA students and other graduate students at Stanford. And the piece that felt the closest and most germane to the work that you do is successful storytelling with statistics. Being able to take data, convert it into something that's meaningful for the designers or the directors or the decision makers that you're trying to convince of something so that you can accomplish the goal that you have. And so putting this together, I recognize you have a much greater grasp of your data than I do. And so I want you to listen to what I share with you in terms of tips and strategies about effective communication and filter it through the types of data sets that you regularly work with and you regularly look at. And inside of that, I think you can find an intersection of how to use the data you're used to get the decisions you want from the people that, that you're trying to work with. When I think about the first time I really was present to somebody using statistics to convince me of something was not in a boardroom at all. In fact, it was in Alaska, and I was on a bicycle. In 2000, I participated in the Alaska AIDS vaccine bike ride. My best friend Javier said, oh, this will be great. And this will be a lot of fun. And it's August. I'm like, okay, a bike ride in August, I could do that. It is cold in Alaska in August. We slept one night underneath at the base of a glacier. Like that was his idea of fun. But at the opening ceremonies, we did a 6-day bike trip that was a 7-day bike trip of 600 miles, so almost 100 miles a day. In the opening ceremonies, before we took off, they wanted to encourage us to keep biking for the week that we were there. And they brought up on stage 28 cyclists representing the 28 million people at that point in time who were afflicted with HIV and AIDS, that the fundraising we were doing could make a difference. Of those 28 million cyclists, 6 were wearing yellow jerseys, and the rest were wearing black jerseys. The 6 represented the 6 million people, mostly here in the United States, or certainly in the West, who had access to the HIV drugs. And the other 22 wearing black jerseys represented those who have no access to the drugs that were available. And then they brought up 12 kids on stage in red jerseys, representing the 12 million orphans at that point in time, mostly in sub-Saharan Africa, who'd lost both mother and father to the disease. That use of statistics in a storytelling setting, now, 17 years later, I can still remember, I can remember the numbers. And for that week, I kept cycling because it had that kind of an impression on me. Now, the data that you and I work with on a regular basis doesn't have that sort of life and death impact to it. Well, okay, in some of the games that you're involved in, it does have that life and death impact. But the decisions that get made are just as important because they matter for the lifeblood of what we're doing. And so if I can use storytelling rather than just handing a bunch of data to somebody and saying, clearly you see, then I can be more effective in my job. So when I think of looking at the process of creating visuals, Albert Einstein early in his career said this about those of us who take data and convert it into charts and graphs. And I love the phrase, he called us violent. And I've actually had some PowerPoint slides in my classes that were violent. They were cruel to me. They talk about death by PowerPoint. And then later in his career, he said it even better. make everything as simple as possible, yet not simpler. And why do we need to have this conversation? Because we see things like this. Stole this off the copier in the faculty room at Stanford. They don't let me, whenever I go to a colleague and I say, can I get a copy of your slides? They're like, no, you can't. Because they know what I'm gonna do with them. Or this. You know it's a bad visual when in the middle of the visual aid, they have to put a paragraph to explain how to understand the visual that they have just placed in front of you. In this, there's trying to be a comparison between desktops, portables, and workstations, looking at it over time. There's no way we can quickly grasp and understand. Or the most egregious, violent use of PowerPoint visuals. Made the cover of the New York Times. Made every nightly comedy show that night. This was a consultant's recommendation to the US military on how to stabilize our efforts in Afghanistan. Crucial issue, not well represented in data. So I don't want that to happen to any of the visuals that you create. And so what I offer as an analogy is to think of anytime you take data and you put it into a chart or a graph to tell a story, it's the tip of the iceberg. And we all know the analogy of the iceberg. Only 10% shows above and 90% is below the water. When you do that kind of analysis to create visuals to convince somebody of something, 90% of your work may never make it into the boardroom or into the meeting or into the deck that you're using, but it's that 10% that is the analysis that shows that's what you want to have be powerful and compelling. So a couple of frameworks for us to think about this, and then I'm going to give you 7 tips for being more effective at storytelling with statistics. First framework, I love to start almost any conversation about communication, is this model developed by Mary Munter and Lynn Russell Mary Munter at Dartmouth and Lynn Russell at Columbia. It's just a simple way to think of any conversation that you're gonna have. If you're gonna send a tweet, if you're gonna send an email, if you're gonna hold a meeting, who is my audience, what is my intent, and what is my message? If I just slow down and think through who is it I'm communicating with and what is it I want them to do as a result of this communication. Too many times what happens, and you can think of bad managers who have done this to you, too many times what happens is we jump immediately to the message and we don't think about tailoring it for the people we're talking to or the action that we want them to take. And if we're more strategic about it, if we think that through, then we deliver the right data to the right people to make the right decision. The other framework that I encourage you to kind of think through is there's two ways that I see people operate with data or statistics when we give it to them. There's kind of a continuum. It goes from one side of the stage to the other. Clear over on the far side of the stage, analysis paralysis. Those are the people who say, oh, let's run one more regression on that. Or can we compare that against the users who used our games last year and 2 years ago and see if there's any difference? And they love diving into Crystal or Excel or Access, whatever they're using to manage the data, and just keep looking and looking and looking and never taking action, never making a decision, because they just love looking and spending time in the data. The other clear end of the extreme is this side, where we just take one story, one user experience of one game, one time, and we make decisions based on it. And we look for the anecdotes that support the point of view that we want, and we ignore the anecdotes that are any other points of view. So that cherry picking is unfair to the data, and spending way too much time in the data is unfair. What we need to do is get into the middle. And in that center where we respect that we've got to do some good analysis, we've got to look at and understand the data, and we've got to look for the stories, in the middle we want to balance the two. The weight of the research that we're looking at and the value of the stories drawn from that. So that's what I want to look at in the time that we have this morning. How do I craft a story? Some tips on how do I illustrate it? And then how do I share it when I want to be able to share it with a group of people? And the best tip that I have about any of this is that the best place to start anything about creating a story is a blank screen. You want to go into a room with a whiteboard. You want to pull out an old sketch pad. You want to go, if you're in your computer, go to the notes document, not into Word and not into PowerPoint, and just think about what is the story that I want to tell. For me, it's a whiteboard. I almost can't be in a meeting that doesn't have a room with a whiteboard because I want to sketch. I want to start thinking about what that story is. And you want to develop the story before you ever develop the graphic. Now, many of you as developers are involved in the storylines of the games that you create. You want to think the same thing through of the data that you're looking at in terms of user experience, in terms of the difficulty of the game, the experience they're having in the game, and their the way that the story is unfolding as you look at that data. And so this should be very familiar to many of you in the room. It's just the classic story arc. This was Freytag's interpretation of it in terms of the five-act drama. But any good, well-told story, any well-crafted game, any well-crafted film has an opening exposition, a beginning, has some sort of climax, and obviously you have multiple climaxes but there's a rising action and then a falling action and some sort of resolution. And over that arc of that story, we want to think about what story can we draw out of the data? What little bit of exposition do I need to give before I hand somebody the data? What is the inciting moment, the decision that we've got to make, the choice we have to make, the product we have to launch or eliminate? How do I get people to that decision and then that things will be better at the other end, at the other side? So think through the story and start sketching before you're ever in any of the analytical tools like Excel. And then know and honor your audience. Get a sense of the decision maker or the designer, the director that you're working with. What is it that you know about them and what's going to motivate them to make a decision? If you don't know who you're writing or speaking to, take some time to do some quick research. Very easy for us to do, you know, internal research inside of our company. Have you met with Kevin before? What does he like? What does he not like? What should I do in the meeting? What should I not do? If it's somebody you haven't met with before, ask other people. If you're doing something externally, using LinkedIn or anything like that that gives you a sense of the audience before you begin to try to communicate to them. How sophisticated of data analysis can I use, or how limited do I need to be in terms of how I deliver it? This is where the AIM model is really helpful for me to really understand the audience before I try to persuade them of anything, before I try to convince them of anything. Those of you who work with people on a regular basis that you know each other well, that audience analysis is just automatic. You know, in my home and in my family, my son knows me. We adopted him 2 years ago, but in that 2 year period of time, he's gotten to know me really well, and he has done audience analysis that he can walk in and quickly get to what it is that he wants from me. So develop the story, know your audience. And then when you get to the illustration side, I urge that we avoid the two high calorie charts, the donut charts, which we saw one a moment ago, and pie graphs. There are more elegant ways and more useful ways to illustrate and share data with people. Give me an example of a badly drawn pie chart. Make it a little bit larger so that you can see it. USA Today has gotten us very used to throwing everything into a pie chart when that's not always the best way to do that level of analysis. Now, this is difficult for you to see, but this is a number of global projects and which ones there's 340 projects total, 264 in scope, we did 92 proposals and 37 wins. but it takes a while of looking back and forth, and the pie chart actually makes it muddier rather than better as an illustration. So one of my colleagues, who I'll reference several times in this talk, Cole Knoflick, who wrote the book Storytelling with Data, she took this chart and put it into bar graphs instead. Taking the exact same data, on the left side you can see the total projects down to how many were in scope, how many proposals, how many won, and how many lost. I can quickly get a sense of that story. And then, and I'm going to step away from the mic for just a moment, the proposal submitted becomes these orange bars up here. Why weren't we submitting proposals? And the proposals lost, there was four reasons why we lost proposals. So going from something that was confusing and ugly and took a lot of time to figure out to something that quickly we could glance at and we could get a sense of. And many times, the simpler illustration will have the more resonance with your audience. Now, the fourth strategy is when you've got a complex story, you can make it easier for people if you break it into multiple slides, if you have the beauty of doing what I'm doing, where I'm projecting. And even if you're handing a deck out to people, I can walk people through the deck in the same way that I use reveals on the screen. So go back to that same story we saw a moment ago. If I only gave you the left hand of the screen as we're talking about that, and then I said, now why aren't we submitting proposals? Here are the top six reasons why we're not. And mostly, what's most important is, why are we losing? Here's the four reasons we lose proposals. So just with simple animation, I can easily let the slide help me tell the story, rather than putting all the data in front of my audience and trying to then fight for their attention to tell the story that I want to tell. One of my other occupations in terms of teaching is not only teaching oral communication and visual communication, but teaching business writing. And I feel strongly the fifth tip is create a strong heading for the data that you have. Don't just put a chart out there that says user experience or 2016 sales or first quarter usage. What about that usage? What about the sales? What about the user experience? Make the heading a little bit longer and use some power verbs. The weakest verbs you can use is, are, was, were, has, have, had. Those are weak, weak, dull verbs, and the more that we use them, we dull down our writing. Initiate, create, lead, manage, eliminate, reduce. Using words that have some life to it makes the headings more interesting. So for example, going back to this same one, my friend Cole wrote that heading. She didn't get R in there once, she got it twice in one headline. She got two weak verbs in there. I took timing and resource issues are top reasons we aren't submitting winning proposals and just said, timing and resources prevent proposal success. Now, took me more time, but the shorter, more active headline is more memorable. If I'm trying to convince a decision maker to do something, that can live in their brain easier than the long sentence with a couple of weak verbs in it. So create strong headings that are the headline for the slide or the individual visual that you're creating. Then when you get into creating the graphics, I encourage we go back to Einstein's philosophy, simplify the graphics for greater impact. Now this isn't, I want to be very clear, especially with a group of developers who see things at such a complex level, this isn't dumbing down your ideas. Quite the contrary, what this is taking your ideas and distilling the essence of what's most important for the person who doesn't know it as well as you to be able to then make a choice or make a decision based on what you know really well. And it's in that synthesis or that distillation that you can then come up with a simple graphic. This is not a simple graphic. Let me make it a little larger for you there. This is comparing online hotel revenue and number of travel agents. And the blues are kind of close to each other, kind of hard to see, but what this is telling us is that the online hotel revenue is getting higher and higher and higher as the number of travel agents gets lower and lower and lower. But I have to look at it for a while. I have to figure out the legend, figure out the colors. They didn't label where the line started. They labeled where it finished up. So I kind of think online hotel revenue is on that. But so any time I add cognitive load to my audience, I make it harder for them to be with the story. This illustration came from a website called Monday Morning Makeover, where people who geek out and enjoy looking at these sorts of illustrations like to take really, really bad examples and make them better. So what they did with this one, they took the exact same data. Now they have the advantage of being able to deliver it on a website here, so they can let it build in front of you. But instead of having the double graph, what they have is online travel agents on the x-axis, online hotel revenue on the y-axis, and they let the year be the data point. So that you can easily, oh, you're not seeing what I'm seeing. I may need a little bit of tech help to have the, let me get out of presenter mode here for a moment, see if I can solve it on my own. We will edit this out. There we go. Okay, now you're seeing what I'm seeing. Online travel agents, we can see the, on the x-axis and online hotel revenue across the bottom, and it builds across. Even if we just froze it right there, where you see the 2000 to 2014, it was just a single view, it still is much stronger than trying to read between the double axis. So looking at the data and trying to figure out a way that we can make the data more understandable and easy for our audience to access. Now, recognizing that this is a audience of people who are used to looking at gaming data, this same website did an example of this in using gaming data. So let's look at that. So the data that they started with, they actually acknowledged it, something from Forbes magazine, Forbes Online, and the person who found the data said, "I really think this is clickbait," and so it was a infographic that is titled the Parents versus Team Video Game Edition. And they illustrated it this way, I think trying to make it look a little bit like a gaming console. I'm not sure, but let me see if I can make this slightly larger for you. Use of gaming devices, adults versus teens. And they were comparing the way that adults and teens use laptops or game consoles or mobile devices. And then they did this really dreadful, this is like the donut chart that we saw earlier, comparing parents and non-parents and their use of data. It was a confusing illustration. The person who does Monday Makeover just put it into two very simple charts. At the top, looking at how do Americans play their games. Adults in the lighter pink and teens in the red, game consoles, desktop, portable gaming, mobile devices. I think this is 2015 data. And the conclusion being over 50% of teens use all forms of gaming devices. And then comparing parents and non-parents, and that in all categories, according to this data, a higher percentage a higher percentage of non-parents use higher percentage of parents use all of the devices, and there's a question on that, is the data accurate in terms of the underlying data? But again, just seeing the illustration of something that was supposed to be an infographic to something that actually lays it out there in a way that I can see the conclusion. The final step that I encourage is that you drill with real data. Once you kind of get this sense of wanting to tell stories with data more effectively, then on your teams to work with real data from your organization and have people do an exercise where they draw stories out of it. And this is the way in which I structure that with teams and groups that I work with. I love to break a group where I've got a mixture, a cross-functional team, where I've got designers as well as developers working together, or people from different divisions working together. Give everybody the exact same set of data and tell them which audience you want to tell a story from. I want you to tell a story to consumers. I want you to tell a story to decision makers, to an industry group. Choose who the audience is. Let them spend 2 or 3 hours in the data, see what stories they come up with, and then come back and present 3 slides of the data that they have arranged. Almost kind of a campfire setting where they get to see what other people came up with the same data that they had. I do this with my students where I give them data based on my doctoral studies at Penn, and I give them an Excel spreadsheet about all of the assignments that were required by my professors and all of the work that went into getting my doctorate. And then I say, what story can you tell from this data? And I'm just going to give you a few quick examples of what some of my students have come up with. One student illustrated it this way, looking at all of my homework, all of the reading that was expected, all of the writing that was expected. And then I also commented upon how long it took our professors to get us our feedback back. And so she did an illustration of 42% of the assignments that I turned in my doctorate got no feedback on. And drew that out, did use a small pie chart, but a way that was effective, and then compared response times on assignments to the feedback. And so that was one student's take on the data set. Another student took the exact same data set and chose to illustrate it this way. Took all of the created a 2x2 matrix. MBAs love 2x2 matrixes. They can put anything into one of these. They combined workload and feedback, and they then went on the web and they figured out the 4 professors who epitomized the 4 types of feedback. Now, they have no relationship. It's just a data set to them. I know these men. And fortunately, the chair of my dissertation is in the top right corner, Bob Zimsky, so I was good with it. What I really love is when you give people a data set and say, what story can you tell from that data? I had a group of MBA students who then decided who they wanted to speak to was the social committee in my doctoral program. We don't have social committees in our doctoral program, but they said, okay, here's what the amount of reading you have to do every month. Here's the amount of writing that's expected. You have a couple of presentations. You have to do a dissertation boot camp. But oh my God, look at November, there's nothing there. That's when we can throw the party. And so it's interesting when you drill with real data what your teams can come up with as a way to look at the same data set. And it's interesting to see what different people will share with different audiences. So I encourage you back in your shops, regardless of how large or how small of a group you work with, to play with this before you try to take data into a meeting to make a decision. So I've talked a lot about crafting the story and illustrating the story. And I'll give you a few resources in a moment, and I'll point out some of the ones that I think are the best. But then you've also got to share the story. You got to have the conversation with the data in front of somebody. So I want to give you a few tips about being able to do that and being able to share the story to the right audience at the right time. For this example, I want to go to the TED library and just show the first 4 minutes of a TED talk. And I chose to, there's some great talks out there about gaming and approaches to gaming and measurement. I looked at some of those last night, but I decided I wanted to take you completely out of what's familiar for you so that you're not battling with the data that they're using and give you an example from a different field. So since we're at UCSF, where a great deal of HIV and AIDS research is done, I pulled a talk from an HIV and AIDS researcher, Elizabeth Paisani. And I just want to look at the first 4 minutes of her TED talk on HIV and AIDS research. And I have now learned how to do this all by myself. We'll go to TED.com. And, ooh, this is not. And we will try this one last time. No, she's not on the YouTube site. So let me go to another example from the TED library, and this is the shortest TED talk ever. And I need to give you a little bit of background here before I play the talk. Hans Rosling, anybody familiar with the work of Hans Rosling? Several people? Hans Rosling just passed away this month, and he is an amazing communicator about data from his research. Does some wonderful stuff on poverty, on global expansion, and has amazing tools in which to tell data. If you watch some of his TED Talks, you're just mesmerized seeing what he's able to make the visuals do behind him. But this talk he did outside of the World Economic Forum, it's 53 seconds long, and it really shows the power of using data to tell the story he wants to tell.
X means unknown, but the world is pretty known. It's 7 billion people. I have 7 stones. 1 billion can save money to fly abroad on holiday every year. 1 billion can save money to keep a car or buy a car. And then 3 billion, they save money to be able to buy a bicycle or perhaps a two-wheeler. And 2 billion, they are busy saving money to buy shoes. In the future, they will get richer. And these people will move over here. These people will move over here. We will have 2 billion more in the world like this. And the question is whether the rich people over there are prepared to be integrated in a world with 10 billion people. That was the shortest TED talk ever given.
So when we are thoughtful about our data and we were clear about who we want to speak to and what story we want to tell, we can use whatever is available to us in the moment to be able to tell that. I want to guide you to some of the steps that I think are the most effective in being able to share a story, as you saw Hans do, or if you are able to later look at Elizabeth Paisani's TED Talk. First of all, as we already spoke, know your audience and meet them where they are at. Be able to meet them and give them data in chunks that they can absorb and that they have enough background on. Two, I encourage you to think about the level of detail in a story to be the Goldilocks level of detail. Don't give them too much, don't give them too little, give them the just right amount of data. And that just right amount of data is what they need in order to make that decision. And then be sure at the end of the conversation to invite that decision, to invite that action. Many times when I see individuals working with senior leaders, they fall short of asking for the action that they want. They don't request the funding they need or the decision that they need. And many senior leaders are moving so fast, if you don't ask for that, you may not get that. And so think about the person you're speaking to and what is it that you want of them, and to be able to then call them to action. So these are the resources that I find the best. Many of you are taking photos of the slides. Let me put it, these are easier way to grab them. Slideology by Nancy Duarte. Nancy Duarte is the only person I know who has a Oscar for PowerPoint design. She did the visuals for Inconvenient Truth that Al Gore got the Oscar that year for that documentary. She's been doing designing slides since before PowerPoint and Keynote even existed. Her book, Slideology, is excellent on this. And then Storytelling with Data by Cole Knoflick, who I've referenced a few times in this talk. And her website, which is very easy to find, storytellingwithdata.com. Great practical examples of how to use data in conversations. The other four books that are up there are also very good, but I think the two most accessible are Nancy and Cole's books. There's also some websites that I'll be sure I make available to the organizers as well, but there are some of the websites that I think are particularly useful at looking at online data and templates to look at data as I share them. So one of my friends, James Buckhouse, who used to be the chief storyteller at Twitter, he's now at Sequoia Capital, he tells my students that it's not the message you send, the story you tell, or even the story they hear that has power. It's the story that they then repeat. If, in the work that you do as a developer, you can create stories around the data and the information that you have access to, and tell it in a way that other people then retell it, you increase your power, your influence, and your ability to do the work you do really well on a regular basis. So we began this conversation in the introduction. Kevin mentioned my son, Tobias. And I've mentioned him a few times. He is an excellent gamer, and he's also excellent at gaming systems. So he moved into our home at the age of 16. My husband and I adopted him from foster care, and we all had a lot of adjustments that we had to make in order to make this family work. And one of the first requests he had of us was a pair of sneakers. Now, I grew up in a small town in Kansas, and we bought our sneakers at Kmart or Payless, like, you know, 20, 30 bucks. Like, yeah, sure, you bet, Tobias, glad to get you some more shoes. He wanted a $500 pair of sneakers. I'm like, no tennis shoes are worth that. I don't pay that for my dress shoes. Like, no, we're not spending that much money on tennis shoes. You're silly, forget it. Well, knowing his audience, he went back, he regrouped, did some analysis of the situation, came into my study one day and said, "Hey, Dad, can we watch a TED Talk together?" I'm like, "Oh, sure, son, happy to do that. You bet." So he logs on to TED, which I'm not going to do because I've had a bad experience of that in the last half hour. He logs on to TED and he pulls up this site, pulls up this talk by Josh Luber. Now, Josh Luber is the world's foremost authority on sneakers and the secondary market of sneakers. And through this 17-minute TED Talk, I learned that if you buy that $500 pair of sneakers and you keep them in the box and in the wrapper, they have a resale value of $2,000. And there's like this incredible like system of people who buy and sell, and they line up outside of the shoe stores on Saturday morning. Like, there's this whole world that he opened up to me. And I said, "Okay, I got it, Tobias. This isn't a pair of shoes, this is an investment." The final slide in Josh's talk compared, if we were to have bought a Jordan Black 3 cement in 2011, it would have gone up in value 162% compared to Apple or the S&P. I was sold. We bought Tobias his $500 pair of shoes. But I needed to be more clear about they stay in the box. Because he wore them and he looked on fleek wearing them, but they now have no resale value, just a great sentimental story. But that's how my son was able to use data to convince this decision maker to do something differently, and with the help of some powerful visual aids. And so my question for you then is, what stories can you tell? Look at the data you have on the users that you have been seeing, the game performance that you have been seeing, the work that you have been involved in. How can you take that data and translate that data into a story that, for the audiences you need to interact with, causes them to take the action that you see as what's recommended? Because your view of the data is closer and richer and more valuable than somebody who just gets a glance at it. But you get to decide what glance they get. I invite you to make it a story. Thank you so much. Thanks. I would be happy to take questions if there are some. Yes?
What happens when the story you want to tell is too complicated?
What happens when the story you want to tell is too complicated, especially when you're talking about like the sort of mimetic outcome you want, which is everybody remembers this story and tells it, and yeah, it becomes like institutional knowledge?
First of all, I would work on doing what I can to get the story as simple as possible. And you may test it with an audience and realize you don't have to give as much of the meta detail as you think. And then if it really is that complicated, do what we know well from comic books. Break it into a serial. Like, give us one part, and then the second part, and then the third part. A friend of mine does designs videos at Oracle, and he can get users at Oracle to launch 10 two-minute videos more than he can get them to launch one 20-minute video. And so you may need to tell it in chunks and bring people along with you. Great question. Yes, right?
So I'm actually curious, like, just high level, if you have any suggestions for telling the story that the listener does not want to hear, because I'm pretty sure we're all familiar with, you know, presenting data that can be, you know, can cause some friction pretty early on. So
I think part of it is just, you know, calling on that courage that, you know, there's a truth that needs to be said there. What I do internally when I have those situations, or when I'm coaching a student through those situations, is to really, like, do that internal work that you are the best person to have this conversation. Don't let those voices say, don't say that. Like, if this needs to be said and you're the best person, like, internally do all of that so that you're confident about it. Externally, to prepare the audience, but not over prepare the audience. So to be able to say, Elizabeth, I've got something we need to sit down and talk about, and I need to get 10 minutes of your time that's really focused, because it's kind of a delicate issue, or it's a concern that I have. Something that raises the red flag and says, we need to make time for this, and we need to make space for this. Then when you're actually in the conversation, don't do any more prefacing or backpedaling. Just lay the information out there. You know, this is what we see. Often I'll use the what, so what, now what. This is what it is. So what? This is why it matters. Now what? This is what I recommend. And if I get pushback, at least I've got a framework that I'm falling back on. Okay? I think we are nearly at the point for the break. So I want to honor the break, but I am here. So do I have the power to release them to break? Or is there somebody with more power?